If you look at this left side of the screen, you will see the right parasternal short axis view of the heart in a dog. And on this view, we call this view mushroom view. So you're looking at the left ventricle, which has like a circular shape. And also there's right ventricle that is kind of wrapping around LV left ventricle, and we call it crescent shape. So that's kind of very normal view of the healthy canine heart. You can also see this two papillary muscles. So we call this mushroom view because this lumen within left ventricle reminds a mushroom. In a healthy patient with normal intravascular volume, that's what the heart should look like. And we call it just normal contractility, just subjectively kind of eyeball assessment of the heart tells us it's probably a patient with normal heart function and intravascular volume. Now, if you're looking at a different patient that has a severe hypovolemia, so this patient bled out, lost a lot of intravascular volume, so now this patient is trying to compensate for that. So you can appreciate the increased heart rate, but also you see that the kind of end-systolic volume and end-diastolic volume are much smaller than in a healthy patient. So the volume of this patient is diminished, and you can see that the left ventricle is kind of shrunk and has less volume within it at the end of diastole and systole, which also is a compensatory mechanism for hypovolemia. So this patient is trying to squeeze harder, but also the heart rate goes up in order to preserve this MAP and overall perfusion to the core organs. So if you see this type of heart on your point of care ultrasound in a patient that also has some abnormal perfusion parameters, you should highly suspect this patient is likely hypovolemic. So we call this hyperdynamic left ventricle. Another view that you could utilize in order to gauge the intravascular volume in your patient is to look at the caudal vena cava. And there are several approaches you can take in order to access caudal vena cava with the probe. But the most common one would be if you put your ultrasound probe right behind the subxiphoid cartilage, and you direct your probe towards the chest. And on this view, you should be able to see the gallbladder. And by the way, this is a sagittal view of the dog with computer tomography, so CT. It's just a nice way to show you the anatomy here. So this is the caudal vena cava that is bringing blood from the abdomen back to the heart, to the right atrium. And you see part of the liver, lungs, a little bit of the heart, gallbladder. So you put the probe behind the subxiphoid cartilage, you direct it toward the chest, and on this view, you should be able to see liver, the diaphragm. So think about the ultrasound beam that is traveling from this area through the gallbladder, through the liver, and then you hit the caudal vena cava, right? So again, that's your probe, this is your skin. So you're going through the liver, you're going through the gallbladder here, and then finally you hit the kind of diaphragm and the caudal vena cava, right? And everything below would be chest. So this is caudal vena cava. And what's interesting is that in patients that are hypovolemic, so lacking intravascular volume, the caudal vena cava diameter may go down, but also there will be very significant variation of caudal vena cava on inspiration versus expiration. And in healthy patient, it should be around, 30-40% variation. Patients that have too much intravascular volume, they're hypervolemic, the variation will be minimal. So the caudal vena cava will be so full that there will be minimal variation between inspiration and expiration. Patients that are extremely hypovolemic will have small caudal vena cava, and the variation in diameter will be greater than 30% based on the research we have today. And sometimes it could be as high as 60, 70, 80% variation. And this is just example of caudal vena cava in a patient that is considered either hypovolemic or euvolemic. So the big issue with this measurement is that patients that are 100% healthy with normal volume status also may have some variation. So it's normal to have variation. And it's important to put together all of the information available. So your physical exam that shows that this patient likely is in shock based on your abnormal perfusion parameters, and but also the variation of caudal vena cava. So if you have a patient that is in shock based on exam plus has variation greater than 30, 40, 50%, then likely this patient is hypovolemic. So now if you have a patient that is in shock, but the caudal vena cava does not change diameter much during inspiration and expiration, then in this case, you should be concerned about hypervolemia. So this patient actually is full in terms of the volume in the intravascular space, and you probably don't want to give more fluids to this patient. So this patient may have right-sided heart failure, or maybe fluid overloaded. If this patient received, you know, liters of fluids a few hours ago, so maybe this patient is now fluid overloaded, and if it's still in shock, you may want to start, you know, vasopressors and think about the pathophysiology behind this shock state. So just to summarize your findings on your point of care ultrasound in a patient that is considered to be hypovolemic, or it also may have distributive shock. So distributive shock means that this patient also have abnormal vascular tone. So the classic example of distributive shock would be septic shock. So patients with severe infection leading to sepsis. Patients that have anaphylaxis. So those patients will have abnormal distribution of blood flow to the periphery instead of the core organs. They may have very, you know, bright red mucous membranes. So they're vasodilated on the periphery. Sometimes we call it vasodilatory shock, distributive shock. So with both hypovolemia and distributive shock, you may see exactly the same left ventricle. So it's going to be hyperdynamic and kind of volume depleted. You may also see the free fluid, right? So if this patient is bleeding, that could be a source of hypovolemia. If this patient has septic abdomen, you may also see free fluid in the abdomen. So that would be also suggestive of possible hypovolemia. However, remember the patient with heart failure, especially right-sided failure, also may have free fluid. So the presence of free fluid does not guarantee you that this patient is hypovolemic. So you need to take into consideration the appearance of the left ventricle, your physical exam, historical information. So it's kind of a complex diagnosis that is based on multiple things that you need to put together. And finally, caudal vena cava also may help. If there's a significant variation in inspiration versus expiration, that may further support the diagnosis of hypovolemia.